Hello, welcome to this lecture. So in this lecture we are going to discuss a very important topic, which is internal loading. Well, this internal loading it is present in almost all the structure member which are subjected to external load, but here in our topic we will be restricted with these two internal loading, which is bending moment and shear force. So in this lecture and in the upcoming lecture we will be discussing more about bending moment and shear force, which are actually the a type of internal loading. So this is the content that we are going to discuss in this lecture. So first of all, we will get introduced with the beam. Why? Because as I said, specifically we will be discussing about the bending moment and shear force. So to understand the internal loading, first of all we will understand what is the beam. Although we have already seen this beam in lecture 3, but now in this lecture we will discuss more about beam, and then we will see what are the internal loading which developed in the beam because of the external load. And then to calculate the internal loading we follow some sign convention, so we will see that. And then we will see what are the steps to calculate the internal loading, and then we will take some example to understand the concept. So now first of all we are going to study the beam. So how do we define a beam? That is based on the nature of force it is subjected to and the dimensional, the physical appearance. So these are the two aspects on which we can define a beam. So for a definition, it says the structural member which is cylinder and which support loads transversely is known as beam. Well, cylinder means an element which has one dimension is very high as compared to the other two dimension, or as compared to the cross sectional dimension. So that member is known as cylinder member. Similarly, it says which support load transversely, which means a member, a body may have different axis. So if an axis passing along the longer side of a body, then that axis may be known as with some name. Similarly, if it is passing perpendicular to it, what will be the name? So first of all I will show you the beam diagram, and in that we will try to understand what are the different axes and what are their names. So this is a beam which is a simply supported beam, and it may be subjected to some distributed load or concentrated load, or maybe some uniformly varying load. So now we are talking about the axis. So the axis which passes through the centroidal axis of beam along the longer dimension. So in this case you can see this is the axis which is passing along the centroid of the beam and which is passing along the longer side of the beam. So that kind of, I mean that axis is known as longitudinal axis. Now the axis which is perpendicular to longitudinal axis, say if this is the longitudinal axis, so if we pass an axis which is perpendicular to the longitudinal axis, then that axis will be known as transverse axis. So here you can see this load and this load, they are passing, these loads are parallel to, I mean their line of action is parallel to the transverse axis, and that is why we say that a member which is cylinder and which support load transversely, or if it support load whose line of action is parallel to transverse axis, then we call it transverse member also. Okay, so this is the longitudinal axis which is passing along the longer side of the body, and transverse axis is the axis which is perpendicular to the longitudinal axis. Okay, so now talking about the internal loading. So whenever we are going to design a structural member, it is very much important to know what are the load which are acting within the member. Within the member means the load which is acting internally. So that load is known as internal loading. Now, why we are required to know this? Well, in order to be sure that the material of the member can resist the load. So therefore, determination of internal loading becomes very much important for designing a member. And these internal loading can be determined by many methods. And one of the very favorite method which we generally use to calculate internal loading is method of sections. And that is what we are going to discuss. Method of section we have already covered in the previous lecture. So the same concept we are going to use here to find out the internal loading for the beam. So now to illustrate the concept of internal loading, take an example of this beam. So this beam is cantilever beam, which is fixed from one end and free from the other end, and it is subjected to two external load. So P1 is exactly vertical and P2 is inclined. Now P2 is inclined, which means it will be having two component. One will be vertical and the other one will be horizontal. So as this is the cantilever beam, so and it is fixed from one end, so fixed support will offer three reactions. So effect of this force will be resisted by the horizontal reaction, which will develop here on the fixed end, and the effect of this vertical component will be resisted by the vertical reaction which will generate at the fixed end. Okay, now here we are going to find out the internal loading. Now because of these two loads, this beam will experience a loading which is called the internal loading. Now how do we find out this internal loading? Well, if we cut a section on the beam, anywhere on the beam, then we can expose that internal loading to find out the magnitude at that particular point. So for example, if we want to find the internal loading which is being developed because of these external force at section AA. So first of all, what we will do is we will cut the beam at section AA. Now, when I say we will cut the beam, we are just visualizing. If we cut the beam, then internal forces will get exposed and they will become external forces. So until we visualize or until we cut the beam, the forces within the member, they will be called internal loading. But once we expose them, once we cut the section at the particular point, those force becomes a external force. Okay. So because of these two forces, what kind of internal loading will develop within the beam? So that we will see. So if we cut the beam at section AA, then we can find out or we can expose these internal loading like this. So at the support, three reactions will generate. One will be the vertical reaction. The other reaction will be the horizontal reaction. Vertical reaction will resist the effect of vertical load, and horizontal reaction will resist the effect of horizontal component of P2. Similarly, another reaction which will develop at the fixed support will be the MA, which will be the moment reaction. Now, as I was talking about the cutting, visualizing the section and internal forces at section AA. So if we cut the beam at section AA, then we have two options. Either we take the left-hand portion of the beam or we take the right-hand side portion of the beam. So whichever part we take, we can expose the internal loading. So for example, if we consider the left-hand side part, so in that case, there will be three internal loading. So because of this force will bend this beam like this. So because of this bending, internal force which will develop in this beam will be the moment force, or the resultant moment force, which is expressed as MB. because we are trying to find out internal loading at point B. So say the resultant moment at point B will be MB. So first internal force will be MB. Similarly, these vertical forces are also trying to slide down this beam down. Similarly, this upward reaction which is trying to get up, this beam trying to get up. So in that case, there will be a sliding force which we are representing as VB. Similarly, because of this P2 load, because of the horizontal component of this P2 load, there may be some component of force along the length of the beam, and that component of force will be known as NB. So this NB force is acting along the length of the beam, this VB force is acting across the beam, and MB is acting in terms of the moment or resultant moment of the beam. So these three internal load will develop because of these external load. Similarly, if we take the right hand side part, then also we can represent the internal loading. But please remember here that the sign convention that we are going to use, if we are taking the left hand side part, or if we are representing internal loading for both part, then if we are taking VB as downward, then on the other face it will be upward, because here the Newton's third law will follow, because we are just visualizing the internal loading. So therefore, if VB on the left hand side part, if it is downward, then on the right hand side part it will be vertically upward to cross them. Okay, so therefore, if MB here is anti-clockwise, then on the right hand side it will be clockwise, because to counter each other. So as I said, Newton's third law will be followed here. So these internal loading MB, N or V, they can be calculated using the method of sections. Now this internal loading, when we talk about the, or when we analyze a member in two dimensional, then these internal loading, number of internal loading which will be acting on the beam in two dimension will be three. One is the shear force, second is the moment force, and the third one is the normal force. So moment force is the resultant moment because of the external load. V is the resultant shear force because of the external load, and similarly N is the normal force. If there is any horizontal force or horizontal component of some force, then this normal force will get active and it will have some magnitude. So here in the two dimensional analysis, M is known as bending moment. So this resultant moment M is known as bending moment. Similarly, this force V, which is acting perpendicular to the or parallel to the face of this beam, this force is known as shear force. Now if we talk about the three dimensional form, if we look a beam in the three dimensional form, then the number of internal loading will be more. So in the second diagram here, you can see if we look at internal forces in a member in a three dimensional form, then obviously we will be having three axes. One is x axis, y axis and z axis. So in the x axis we will have two type of internal loading, one in the form of resultant moment and the other in the form of normal force. So as you can see, this normal force is along the x axis, so we are representing this as nx, and it is acting along the length of the member. So this, the effect of normal force on the beam will be like beam may get contracted or beam may get expanded. Similarly, the effect of moment along the x axis, so you can see the moment which is acting along the x axis, it is trying to rotate this beam like this. So in that case, what is happening? The beam is trying to twist. and therefore the moment which is acting along the x axis we call it as torsional moment. Now if we talk about the internal loading along the y axis, which is being developed because of the external force, so here also two internal loading is developing. One is sliding, I mean beam may get slide along the y axis, it may slide downward or upward. So that sliding effect is represented by the effect of V. Now this V here is shear force, because the movement of the beam is across the section. So therefore Vy is the shear force along the y axis. So this Vy will be generated if the load is along the y axis. If the external load is also in the direction of y axis. Similarly, if there is a load along the z axis, then what will happen? In that case, the beam may try to get slide down like this, and therefore this VZ is also acting across the section, and therefore this is also a component of shear force. So this VZ will be generated if the external load is along the Z axis. And another internal loading along the Y axis will be MY. Now effect of MY we can experience if load is acting like this, then in that case beam will bend like this. Okay, I will take an example of beam. For example, there is a beam like this. If the load is acting like this, I'm also making the axis. This is y axis, x axis, and z axis. So if load P is acting along the y axis, in that case beam will bend like this. So you can see this beam is making a curve, which is, so it means beam is bending along an axis like this. So this axis is basically z axis. So in that case beam will experience this bending along the z axis. So when P is acting along the y axis, then moment which will be generated here will be about the z axis. Similarly, if we take another example, now suppose if the load is acting like this, so in that case beam will bend like this. So you can see now that this bending will be happening along the y axis. So it means the beam is trying to rotate along the y axis, while in the earlier case beam was trying to rotate along the z axis. So if load is acting along the y axis, bending moment will be generated along the z axis. Similarly, if load is acting along the z axis, in that case bending moment will be happening along the y axis. So that is the concept here. So therefore MY can be another component of which may be referred as internal loading. So this is also a component of MZ, while MX is torsional moment. Why? Because if beam is rotating like this, so you can see beam will be rotating along the longer axis or along the longitudinal axis. So in that case the moment here will be known as torsional moment, while the moment, because of moment about y axis and z axis, they are actually bending the whole beam. They are actually bending the whole beam, and therefore the effect of bending moment along y axis and z axis, they are actually the component of bending moment. But bending along the x-axis, it will be known as torsional moment or twisting moment, the moment which will try to twist a beam. Okay, so that is the overall picture of internal forces in two-dimensional form and three-dimensional form. So here in our course, we are limited to analyze a beam in the two-dimensional form. So in the two-dimensional form, so this V is actually Vy, this M is actually Z, and this N is actually Nx. So N is the normal force along the x-axis, M is the resultant moment about the z-axis, because we are assuming that external load will be passing along the y-axis. So because of this load, the internal load which will generate will be in terms of shear force Vy, in terms of bending moment Mz, and in terms of normal force Nx. Now this Nx will be generated if there is an inclined force. So the horizontal component of the force will have some significant role in getting the value of normal force. So now before we calculate internal loading, we need to have some sign conventions. So as I said, we will mainly analyze our beam in two-dimensional form. So in this, if the shear force is downward, what will be the sign convention? If it is anti-clockwise, what will be the sign convention? And if it is left to right, what will be the sign convention? So to understand that, I will now show you the sign convention. So here, say this is the beam which is trying to sag like this. So if we cut this beam from the center, so whenever we are calculating the internal loading, we will always choose a section, whether we take left hand side of the beam or we consider the right hand side of the beam. So if we consider the left hand side of the beam or left hand side part of the beam, so on the left hand side part, if we have clockwise moment, then we will consider it as positive moment. But by chance, if we consider the right hand side part of the beam, in that case, anti-clockwise moment will be considered as positive. Similarly, in case of hogging moment, if a beam is having shape like this because of the external load, so in that case, again, if we cut the section, so in that case, if we consider the left hand side part, so the moment which will be anti-clockwise will be taken as negative. And if we consider the right hand side part, then moment which will be clockwise will be taken as positive moment. Similarly, in case of shear force calculation, so again, if we cut the beam from the center, so if we are considering the, or if we want to calculate the positive shear force, so in that case, if we are considering the left hand side part, then all the vertically upward force will be considered as positive force. And if we are taking the right hand side part, all the force which are downward will be taken as positive. And this is the vice versa in case of negative shear force. Okay, so in case of positive shear force, if we are taking the left hand side part, then upward force will be positive. Or if we are taking the right hand side part, then downward force will be positive. And this is the vice versa of this. We will understand these sign convention more when we will be taking an example. So we will continue our discussion in the next part. Thank you.